Good day to you all. Welcome to this DevOps webinar hosted by Exyn. Today I'm with Gert-Jan van Halem. My name is Simone van Zuylen and I will be your host. The webinar will be about DevOps and why should you care? Everyone is talking about DevOps. The function title of all IT personnel is changing to DevOps engineer. But what is DevOps and where does it come from? And most important, why should you care? Gert-Jan van Halem will be the presenter. He works at DevOps team and as a principal DevOps consultant. Gert-Jan is a long-time lean and agile enthusiast. He loves to help teams and organizations to add more value for their customers. Note, you're all on mute. You can ask questions using the chat function throughout the webinar. And at the end, there will be some time left to really answer all the questions. The webinar will be recorded and you will receive the recording today or tomorrow, so you can listen to the webinar again. Enjoy the webinar. The floor is yours, Gert-Jan.
Thank you very much, Simone, and thank you for having me. And also all the attendees, thank you for being in this webinar. Well, as Simone said, and as you probably noticed, DevOps is kind of hot nowadays. If you call yourselves a DevOps engineer on LinkedIn, you will get the attention of a lot of recruiters. But what is it? And that's what I want to talk to you about today. And you will discover, I hope, today that that's quite a broad topic. So I had to make some choices on what I will cover on that. But still, I think I will cover quite a bit. So I will try to give you a most solid introduction into DevOps as possible. But I won't go into great depth on all these subjects. If you want to talk more in great depth of any of the subjects that I touch, please contact me. I am very happy to do so. So let's take a look at the agenda. Of course, I will talk about what DevOps is. So we'll try to find a definition for that. I also want to touch on why DevOps is so hot right now. Eh? What made it all of a sudden make it such a booming term, and why is everybody into DevOps? Then I'll go into a couple of principles driving DevOps, and I'll touch on how you could start doing it yourself. And as Simone said, there will be enough time for some questions left, I guess, at the end. So first, a little bit about me. I'm Gert-Jan van Halem, a consultant at DevOps team. DevOps team is a consultancy firm that delivers innovative technology consulting for businesses. We are present in about 18 countries in the Middle East and Europe. I'm based in the Netherlands myself and joined approximately 4 years ago. I've been doing DevOps, I think around 10 years by now, but I'm not sure if we called it DevOps back then, but it's quite the same, I think. I have a background as a software engineer. I have a master's degree in software engineering and have a lot of experience as a manager of IT departments. And in that function, I came into contact with stuff like Lean and Agile and DevOps, and actually found it that interesting that I changed my career to being a consultant in that area. So what I do nowadays mostly is help companies to make the change to working more lean, adopting Agile and applying DevOps principles in their IT departments. Well, so that DevOps thing, what is it? Well, first thing I do if I want to know what something is, I go to Wikipedia and I'll find the definition for DevOps. And if you look it up on Wikipedia, this is what you'll get. And this is not an untrue statement, but again, it's not completely the whole story, I would say. If you read this, you will see that it has a lot of focus on dev and ops, developers and operations. It says, okay, it's the combined word of development and operations. So clearly the focus is on dev and ops, but it's broader than that. Completely at the end, they mention something about close alignment with business objectives. And actually that's the closing sentence on Wikipedia in the definition, but I think that's the most important part that we should focus on, and that's what I will come back on a lot in this presentation. And on Wikipedia, as you see, they define it as a set of software development practices, and I think that's not an untrue statement, but it's totally not the whole story. So let's dive a little bit deeper, because what happens and what you see a lot and what you see on Wikipedia definition as well is this picture, and it's a picture you probably know because it's shared a lot throughout all kinds of DevOps presentations. And of course, it's a funny picture, so it's good to share it a lot. But this is also what happened in real life. We had a dev organization, a development organization with all the programmers and system engineers, software engineers, and then we had an ops operations department that has to make sure that all the services keep on working and keep on doing their stuff, and all the developers want to do change. They want to create new software every day, while the operation guys want to have stability. They are responsible for the production environment to have it as stable as possible. So they are hesitant to change, while the software developers want to change every day. And when something happens on production, software developers will say, it worked fine in dev, it's your problem now. And it's actually that wall of confusion that DevOps is trying to get rid of. So that big wall that's there between dev and ops. But it's not only between dev and ops. There's also a big wall of confusion between all other silos that you can find in an organization. So there are people in the business trying to get the requirements in. They will also have a big wall of confusion to the system developers. So walls of confusion tend to exist between every department in an organization. That's why I say, okay, yeah, it's about dev and ops, but it's broader than that, because if we want to focus on adding value to our customers, we have to look to the whole chain and not only to dev and ops. So somebody who did a lot of work in this area is Patrick Dubois. Actually, he's called the godfather of DevOps, because he kind of coined the words when he started the DevOps days in 2009 in Belgium. It's a Belgium guy. And the first DevOps days were in Belgium, organized by Patrick Dubois. And I share a link here on from YouTube. And in that YouTube video, Patrick Dubois talks a bit about what he thinks DevOps is. And he came up with the term, so let's ask Patrick Dubois. And he actually is a bit hesitant to make a definition of DevOps. And the reason for that is that his reasoning is, if I define it strictly, then you would think, okay, this is what DevOps is, so I just have to do this and then I'm done. And actually it's something that he wants to continue to improve on and continue to evolve to something that may help us to break the silos more and more and more and add value to customers more and more and more. So he wasn't willing to make a very precise definition, but if he's pressed to do so, he will say something along the lines of aligning the silos, making sure that everybody in the company is working together to add value to the customers. And what's interesting with that as well is that DevOps is kind of an IT thing. It was kind of an IT thing maybe, and maybe if you think about DevOps and develop operations, you think about IT and tools and all kinds of stuff. And what he says in the same clip as well is, culture is way more important than tools. The tools in the whole DevOps world are the enabler, but the culture will make the tools effective. So the tools only, yeah, you need them, but the tools only won't do the trick. The culture is way more important to make effective use of the tools. So as you see, we came from dev and ops, and we are now talking about culture, adding value to our customers, having the whole company aligned with each other to actually add that value more and more. And that's actually something that's not new. If you look into the last century to the automotive industry, you'll find something that you might know as lean, because that's the term that's used a lot. And Toyota is very famous for that implementation of all kind of lean and lean manufacturing systems. And it's a bit about what happened in the last century is depicted in these two pictures. So on the left side, we have a Ford factory beginning of the last century. On the right side, you have a Toyota factory at the beginning of this century. And the difference, well, of course, you see a lot of difference there. You see on the left side, you see around 20 people trying to create a wheel for a Ford. While on the right side, there's only one guy looking at how a motor is created. So it changed completely from a lot of manual work to a lot of automated work. And of course, that's the state of technology that's there, that wasn't there 100 years ago. But maybe the most important part is the quality. So the guy that's trying to develop, to create a motor, isn't creating the motor. He is not touching the motor at any place, but he is watching the quality of the process that creates the motor. So that when it's created, the quality is always the same. And the process is improved. So not the production itself, but the process that creates your product is improved. So there's a lot of focus on the process and on automating the process and increasing the quality of the process instead of a lot of focus on the product itself and trying to create that as good as possible with a lot of manual work. So what you see in the DevOps world is actually that a lot of what happens in DevOps and in-house software development and operations is done nowadays. It has a lot to do with what happened with the whole lean manufacturing system in the last century and what, well, you might say finally flow into the IT companies. So we added lean to the whole mix of the DevOps. We started with developers trying to create software and operators trying to maintain it. It has apparently something to do with lean and culture. So a good acronym that's used a lot to explain what DevOps is comms. Keep comms, and then you have culture, automation, lean, measurement, and sharing. And as Patrick Dubois pointed out, culture is essential element for successful implementation of DevOps. The tools alone will only be effective if your culture embraces that. And yes, then you need the tools and you need to automate a lot of stuff. And automate everything might be a little bit exaggerated, some things you might not want to automate, but automate a lot and almost everything, I would say, and remove the boring work while increasing the quality and speed. And that's something that I will touch on a little bit later as well. Quality and speed can go together if you do automation correctly. And then look at that with a lean focus. So try to reduce waste and focus on adding value for your customer. Always look at where's the waste, how can I add more value for my customer? And to do that, of course, you have to measure a lot. You only when you measure and you know what's happening and you have visibility into the stuff that's happening in your software factory and in your operations department, then you know what's happening. And if you don't know what's happening, something will go horribly wrong sometime. And well, maybe a little bit of a culture thing, but important enough to point on separately is sharing. You have to foster collaboration. And that's not just making your documentation accessible for everyone in the company, but it's talking about it. It's finding each other, setting up communities, discuss how you work, discuss what you want to achieve in order for everybody to be aligned on the same target. What, again, is adding value to our customers. So for now, that's I would like to stop here with what DevOps is, because as you see, you can come from different directions into defining DevOps, and there's a lot to say about it. But if you keep in mind that it's always about adding value to your customers and making sure that the whole company is aligned with that target, then I think you have the right mindset of what DevOps is, and everything will be depending on that. So a little bit, and that's something that will come back a couple of times, is so why would you do this? So great, everybody's doing DevOps. That's fantastic, probably, but why would you? And that's actually something that's a lot of research is being done in that area lately. I would say last 6 or 7 years. And it's something that you might know as the DevOps, State of DevOps report that's coming out every year. And what they find in the State of DevOps report, they do statistic analysis of what's happening in the world with people working in DevOps. And when you apply all these principles correctly, you will get a faster lead time. And as when I say lead time, I of course mean I get new features out to my customers faster. So I'm adding business value and customer value again. And not a little bit faster, but up to more than 400 times faster lead times for changes. I spend less time on security issues, and all that gives me more time for new work. So again, in terms of customer value, I will be able to add more value to my customers just because I have more time to spend on that instead of making sure that security issues, incidents, and all kinds of stuff like that is being solved. And also very important, also because nowadays in the market, it's hard to get good people in your company. And when you have to keep people in your company, you want to keep them, and to keep them, you want to have them happy. Well, working in a way like this, and it has, again, it has a lot to do with culture and way of working, will make your employees happy. And well, 2.2 times happier employees, that might sound a little bit weird to you. How do you measure that? But I'm sure that also in your companies, the HR department is busy on measuring how good you're doing as an employee. Well, applying DevOps principles in your company will make your people more happy. So enough reason to do it. But then this is not something new. I told you in the automotive industry, this is going on for around 100 years. And of course, in IT, it's different, and IT is not that old. So, but we started with IT completely different. And it's only the last couple of years, as I said, Patrick Dubois started with the DevOps days in 2009. So let's say that that's the side of DevOps, and that it's growing, and it's growing rapidly. So why did it happen now? Again, that's a topic that you can address from a lot of different angles. And what I want to do now is to approach that from the angle of the silos that I talked about earlier, and that Patrick Dubois also mentioned when he says, let's align all the silo in a company. So I want to take a bit of an organizational approach. There are other approaches to take, so bear with me. And if you have questions about it, please ask them. I will go into it after this. But I want to start with the silos. How did these silos came along? And you might know the law of Conway, because it says that organizations which design a system are constrained to produce designs that which are copies of the communication structures of these organizations. So that's a lot of words which you might want to think about a little bit, but let's see how that works. You could already, if you see this, think about a company which creates a website for the first time. And what happens a lot in organizations that do that, they produce a website with content and structure that mirrors the internal concerns of the organization rather than the needs of the users of their sites. So you might have a page per department instead of a page per product that you try to sell. But this happens in a larger way as well. And let's dive a little bit in the history. Let's say this is the first IT department ever in your organization, and that might have happened 20, 30 years ago, something like that. And IT was completely new. So you had a CEO and you had a sales and operations department. And with operations, I mean just your business operations, making sure that your customers are helped and stuff like that. And it, of course, there's always a staff organization. But then IT happened and the CEO decided, hey, we need to focus on that IT stuff as well. So let's create an IT department. So there's an IT department. It's probably quite small in this time. And people start creating applications in the IT department to help the rest of the organization. So if you apply Conway's law, what happens is that you get this kind of applications. One silo, so you get one application. There are a couple of guys that know everything about that application. You can call them, they will fix it for you. In organizations like this, 20, 30 years ago, people were quite happy with IT because it was a small organization. They were flexible. If you called them, they could help you. It was just one application, and that worked. And it made sense. There was one IT department, so one application, one silo, so to say. But then IT grew. And while it was growing, the CIO got in place. We first only had a CEO, but then the CIO came along and said, okay, I have to make this organization work. So let's think about how I would organize that. And well, it seems sensible to organize that along specialisms. So we have front-end developers, we have middleware developers, some back-end developers, we have an infrastructural department, making sure that everything keeps working on production. And in this way, we can create applications. And again, applying Conway's law, what happened is that we create applications like this. So we have more silos now, and there's something on top probably that might be that middleware department that makes sure that everybody talks to each other. You could see that as a separate silo on top of it. But okay, this is becoming more complex. So we have a front-end silo, we have a back-end silo, middleware is trying to connect everything while the infrastructure people try to make everything work on production. So that makes sense, and it kind of worked, because I think if you've ever worked in an organization of some size, then you've worked with applications like this. But then you also know that it's becoming quite hard to get stuff done. But we found a way around that, and we call that project managers or program managers, and they're located normally in the staff. So what happens if a new project comes along? There's a project manager that goes into the CIO organization, goes to talk to all the managers probably, try to plan everything according to the timelines that he got. make a big Gantt chart on what should happen, when should it happen, who should be involved, trying to get the right people out of the organization to help them with this project. And a lot of time, and I've been in one of the management positions in this picture, a lot of my time also went up into Excel sheets trying to plan things. There's always more work than that. I had people in my team, so I had to disappoint project managers. We had to have big priority discussions. If you want to do this, we can't do this. If you want to do this, you also have to involve that other department because there's a dependency. So also the dependency management became quite hard and difficult to do in an organization like this. And we found a way around that with all kinds of Gantt charts, change advisory boards, all kinds of structure to try to get control of this organization. And while doing that, we got disrupted. Stuff like this happened. We had Uber, we had Airbnb. I'm from Holland, so I'm kind of proud of Adyen in the payment sector. I'm not sure if you know that, but great guys that disrupt the complete payment sector. And there are a lot of examples. We call it the platform economy. Platforms are being created. A lot of companies that used to be hotel companies or taxi companies or banks are becoming IT companies with a banking license or a taxi license or a hotel license, but the focus is on IT. And one way or the other, these guys manage to be flexible, to be fast, and to be able to make changes very fast, what was very hard for us to do in a big organization with all these silos and trying to manage everything and get everything to work. And this is not just a coincidence that these companies started to happen. You could say, of course, there's a need for this. People want to be fast. People want to have the flexibility. They want to have the app on their phone to make it happen. And there's one guy called Mark Andreessen who made the quote, "Software is eating the world." And his quote is, "Everything is becoming software." And Mark Andreessen knows what he's talking about. If you don't know him, you probably do use software that he created. He's the founder of Netscape. And before he founded Netscape, he created Mosaic. And if these terms don't say anything to you, then in every part of every browser that you use to browse the internet, some piece of software from Mark Andreessen is there, because it's still depending on what he did with Netscape, one of the first major browsers in the world. And nowadays he's a venture capitalist and he does a lot of investments. And he invests in companies that make this happen, that create software to disrupt companies, because that's the model that's working. But that's a big problem for a lot of other companies that have that big organization that specialize in all kinds of ways. So we need to change, because we lost track of the product and we were focusing on projects because we were optimizing for internal performance instead of customer focus. So we have to change the way we are organizing our IT departments to, again, and maybe our complete companies even, to again focus on the customer. So that silo that's there needs some work. We need to redefine the silo. We need to have some work done on the silo. It might be not completely feasible to destroy all the silos, but with Conway's law in mind, you now know that the way you organized has something to do with the software that you will create. So you have to think about, what software do I want to create? What products do I want to create for my customers? And if I want to do that, how should I be organized? And with all the things that I told you about what's happening with Lean, how we look at the DevOps world and some of the principles that I already mentioned, that organization has to be customer focused on customer value. You have to look at the value stream. I'll talk a little bit more about that in the next couple of slides. But you have to look on how value is streaming through your company. And you have to be able to adapt quickly to minimize waste. So in a sense, you organize for change. And maybe even we are used to having organizations that are there and we reorganize every now and then. But the organization is not the goal. The organization is the result of what you want to do, and you have to be able to change that very quickly. The companies that are disrupting all other companies are able to change that organization quickly, because the organization is not what it is about. It's about what we deliver to our customer. And the good news is you can do it. This you're not the first one. If you're thinking about doing something with DevOps now, it's being done. And what I said earlier, if you do it, you can have quality and speed. So if you struggle now with quality and speed, because you have this big organization and change advisory boards and all kinds of Gantt charts, making sure that the right people are working on the right thing, you also experience that the quality is sometimes lacking and the speed is totally lacking. But the good news is that quality and speed do go together. Again, the same research that I pointed out earlier, in that research we find that what we call the high IT performance can deploy frequently, multiple times per day, with a lead time of less than an hour. So if you want to have a change and you want to bring it to production, that can be done within an hour, while having a change for failure rate of between the 1 and 15%. That's to say, every change, or maximum 15% of every change, will lead into a failure. And that's the lowest measured over the whole research. So you can have speed and quality combined when you apply DevOps principles. So that's the good news, it can be done. So let's dive a little bit deeper in what you need to do to achieve that. Value stream, I already mentioned it. You have to think about your value stream. But before I dive into value stream, I want to dive a little bit deeper in what that value stream stuff is and where it comes from, because this is typically a lean term. And in lean, you have five principles. It is all about value. We want to optimize the value for our customers. But value is created within your company in a stream. If you look at, again, the automotive industry, it might be the most tangible to look at. A car is just flowing through your company, and every step that it takes, value is added. And that's how you have to look at your IT process as well. What does my IT process look like? And does every step in that IT process add value for my customer? And then you have to do that in a flow. You don't want to have stuff lying around. And also in IT, we have a lot of stuff lying around. If you have somewhere an Excel sheet or a system like ServiceNow or whatever, with all your requirements and all your incident in it, then you have stuff lying around, you have stock, your IT stock, and your process isn't flowing. And to create flow, you have to think about pull. And that's to say, we don't push stuff to customers, but we create products that customers want. So the customer will pull our process and we will deliver applications for that customer. And the thing driving this all within lean is perfection. So that's a very, very quick introduction into lean and the principles. And I mentioned that because when we look into value stream, I like the quote of Taichi Ono. He created a Toyota production system based on lean. And what he's saying is that all they are doing in that Toyota factory is looking at the timeline that when a customer gives an order to the point that the cash is collected. So that's a very economically based timeline. And somebody's ordering a car, we want to get paid for that. So everything we do in between has to be reduced, and we reduce it by removing non-value added waste. We don't create things that the customer doesn't ask for. We create only that what he wants, so that we can get paid as fast as possible. So there's a very sensible economic reason behind it as well. And that gives you a lot of focus on what are we actually doing, and what we are doing, is it waste or is it actually adding value? And again, in IT, if I try to translate that to IT for you, I think a very good example of waste that we do in IT has a lot of to do with requirements in how we create software. And it's especially in organizations, as I showed earlier, the large organizations specialized in silos of front-end, middleware, stuff like that. When you finally have that project and you have all the money in place and all the budgets are there for you and the project manager has it done all, you probably try to squeeze in as much as possible in that project, because this is your chance, right? You now have all the people focusing on your project. Everybody is ready to work for you. So even if the customer didn't ask for it, try to get it done. Even if you don't know if the customer actually wants it, but only because you think they might want to have it one day. So that's something that's created a lot of waste. And the other thing in IT that creates a lot of waste, I'm not sure, but if you're a developer and listening to this, I'm sure I did it as well, developing stuff. You always make it nicer than it needs to be. So when your code is done, you're always thinking, this might be nice as well. Let's add that as well. And again, a lot of waste. The best example I've ever seen is, I think it was Excel 97. When you know the cheat codes, you can play a complete flight simulator in Excel 97. Why? just because a developer thought it was nice to do. But I don't think any customer expects to be able to do a flight simulator in Excel, and they totally didn't buy it for that. So there's waste that's being created a lot within IT. The problem within IT is that it's sometimes quite covered up with a lot of Excel sheets and systems, so it's hard to see. But there's waste in every process in IT. So value streams can help you uncover that, because it starts with understanding your value stream with measuring a lot. And that's measuring in when I get something done, how is it getting done? Who is doing what work? How much time does it take that for that work to be done? How much time does it take waiting around before somebody gets to it? And when you see these figures, you will be shocked, because when you look at the normal, maybe nowadays it's not normal anymore, but what you still see a lot is that going to production is something that happens a couple of times per year. So creating the software between will take maybe a couple of days, but it will take you 3 months before it's in production. So the ratio between how much work do we do and how much time does it take to get it into production is very, very wrong in a lot of places. And you will get shocked if you do it for the first time. And then we'll focus by visualizing. So you can have this whole value stream on the wall of your office. You can visualize what's happening so that you can focus on where do we improve? Where do we want to create value? And not just by taking actions, but by actually creating value in your value stream. It's not about doing work, it's about adding value. And visualizing it makes it very easy to see, hey, but this is a bottleneck. Hey, if you visualize it with the measurements on it as well, you will see the bottleneck in a glance. And you can optimize, but I'd like to stress, look at the halt when you start optimizing. Don't sub-optimize, you will create a worse process. But you see it happening. If you visualize it, you will see it happening and you will be able to optimize the whole. And then you can implement flow and create a cadence. Cadence is quite important to get stuff done. In IT, we sometimes call it a release train or something like that. But having cadence is a great way to get things done in your value stream. So let's move on from value streams to deployment pipelines. The second principle that I want to discuss, that might be more well known to a lot of technical people, at least, to have continuous delivery. It's called a lot of in a lot of books, and I will go into that a little bit more as well. But first, I want to mention that the deployment pipeline is not a pipeline in the sense of what you might think with an oil pipeline. You get something in and it will get out of the other side. It's a feedback loop. It's all about feedback. And every change that we make in our system should trigger a feedback process. And the people that can act on that feedback, so that have the knowledge to do it, should receive that feedback as soon as possible. And a pipeline could be something as I depicted below here. So you have a commit stage, an acceptance stage. Well, you can have as many stages as you want. But the key always is to have it in a feedback loop. So if it goes to the next stage, that triggers feedback. And that feedback goes back to the people that can actually act on that feedback. So it's all about getting the feedback as soon as possible at the right place, so that people can act on it. And when I say continuous delivery, this is the first book that I highly recommend to everybody that didn't read it already. This is, well, for me, it's kind of the Bible of continuous delivery, written by Jess Humble and David Farley. And this states kind of, well, you could call it architecture for continuous delivery. And it gives a lot of details in anything and everything that goes into that. And these points that they mention in that book, I'd like to highlight. I won't go through them all, but I'll highlight a couple of them. It should be a repeatable, reliable process. And when I say that, I almost automatically mean it's automated. Otherwise, it won't be repeatable or reliable. Version control is key for everything. And the one that I like most is, if it hurts, do it more often. We have kind of a tendency to postpone the hard stuff to the end of a project. Please start with the hard stuff. You will learn a lot in the beginning, and you will make sure that the easy stuff you'll get done anyway. So start with the hard stuff, make that happen. You will get more reliable with all the timelines that you have if you do that. And the last one that I want to highlight in this bullet is that everybody's responsible for the delivery process. In more traditional, let's say, waterfall kind of organizations, you see often that there's somebody like a release manager or a change manager that's responsible for the delivery process. But actually, if we say we want to add value, then that's something that we say to everybody in the company, and everybody is responsible for this delivery process and to help add value. And we only add value if we can bring something to production. So this is a very, very important process in your company. So, and then we combine that with configuration management. And with configuration management, I always like to talk about the pets and the kettle. We are used to, and this might be a little bit of a weird analogy when you are not into animals or you are totally into animals, but bear with me and let me explain it. We are used to looking at servers and all kinds of infrastructural components as our pets. We know them, we know what they're called. They're not nice names, but sometimes they're even very nice and names that you would also call your pet. And we take good care of them. If your cat gets sick, you bring him to the doctor and you'll ask some medicine and hope that he gets well. We do the same with servers. If they break, we go into the server, we'll become root, we'll change stuff, we install stuff, we'll add configuration, whatever, to make our server work again. But more and more what we are doing is getting away from that paradigm and going to a paradigm where we see it more as cattle. We have a lot of servers lying around. If you only think about the cloud, it's almost endless, the capacity that you have. And why should I take good care of a server? I only need a server at the moment that I want to do a test or have a need for some loads. And then I need that server. And when I'm done with it, I want to throw it away again. And it's more like a kettle. You raise it for a purpose. And when the purpose is done, you don't need it anymore. So what that means is that configuration management is becoming code as well. So I have infrastructure as code. Infrastructure is not a component that I have and that I take good care of. Infrastructure is a component that I create based on code when I need it. And when I don't need it anymore, I throw it away. It's something that I don't need then. So if you combine these two, configuration management and your deployment pipeline, you'll get something like this. And I won't go into depth, but I highly recommend the book that I mentioned before, Continuous Delivery, because they will explain this picture. And what's good to remember now is that everything is in version control, not only your software for the product that you create, but also the infrastructure which you use to host that product, to test that product, to do acceptance on that product. Everything is in version control and recreatable from version control. And then actually you might say that everything below that, yeah, it might be even less important because I can recreate it as long as I have my version control in place and if I use that in the right way. So this is something that I could easily talk about for a couple of days, so I won't do that for now. If you want to, please let me know. I'll say again, because this is the key of continuous delivery and getting this in place in the right way. So then the definition of done, next principle. So we had the value stream, we looked at continuous at the deployment pipeline, at configuration management, but we also like to focus on a definition of done because we want to get things done. And we used to look at definition of done in terms of my code is committed and it's in version control, especially developers. My work is done, it's in version control, good luck with rest. But that's not done because no customer can use it. So you might say, okay, but I did a successful user acceptance test. Great, but still nobody can use it. But my product is deployed to production. Okay, now we're getting somewhere. And now we have a customer that can actually use my product. So this might be a nice definition of done. But I want to challenge you to take it even one step further and say, is the objective met? So why did you create this product? What was your goal with this product? And did you, for example, think you might get more revenue when you made a change to your product? And if you thought that, if that was your hypothesis, sorry, that's a difficult word for me. If you thought this might be the thing that I need more revenue, are you really getting the revenue? And if not, you probably need to make a change. So again, this is a feedback loop. If your code is committed, you get feedback. If your UAT is successful or not, you get feedback. If it's deployed to production, you get feedback. And you get feedback on the objective that you had with the change that you made. So it's all about the feedback loop, and a definition of done. Something is only done when the objective that you had was met. So not even on production, but try to take it a step further, because remember, it's about adding value, not adding code. So nice, interesting, but how to start? And again, I always like to start with the why. Why should you start? We found in that same research that I mentioned now a couple of times that high performing teams are twice as likely to exceed, not just in creating nice software and doing IT wonderful, but in profitability and productivity and effectiveness and customer satisfaction. So really the stuff that your business and your customers care about. So it's not just on having IT working fine. It's about making sure that your customers get the product that they need so that you get the revenue that you probably want. So that's why we do it. And if we look at that, we call it organizational performance. That's just the business goals that we have. Then we also know from that same research that IT performance does influence organizational performance. If I get better IT performance, my organizational performance will increase. And to do that, I have a lot of things that I can work on. So it's from the culture part, you can think about climate for learning, leadership. We talked about lean and agile practices, of course, technical practices like continuous delivery. So there's a lot of stuff influencing the IT performance. And that's actually the stuff that we can work on and that we can influence in order to get our organizational performance and our customers happy. And when you start with it, I would recommend to you start measuring, because it's about that performance that we want to have, and we know how to measure that performance. And there are a lot of KPIs in the world, but if you think about measuring and what should I measure, start with these. What's your lead time? How long does it take for something to go to production? How often does that fail? If you bring it to production, does it fail or not? What's the availability? Can my customer actually use it? And how much time does it take to restore it if they don't use it? And how often can I deploy? And that's all in some way or another connected with each other. But these are the five important performance indicators that tell you how your IT performance is doing. So this is the stuff that we want to improve on, because again, if we improve this, our organizational performance will improve. And with that measurement, we will be able to find the bottlenecks. And again, if you think back on what I told about value streams, let's have it visualized on the wall. Find your bottleneck in your process. See how that affects the measurement that we take. Make the change. Fail fast with that change, because if you fail fast, you learn fast and improve fast. It might be nice to have all kinds of great stuff happening and avoid failure. But failure will come. If you make a change, you will fail. If you fail today, you can change today, you can learn from it today, you can improve today. If you fail tomorrow, you have a day wasted in which you didn't learn and didn't improve. And when you did that, measure again, because it's all about the performance that we want to bring to our customer. So it's not about having a change and having our process nicer and nicer and nicer if the customer isn't helped with that. So we measure again to see what the impact was of what we did. And then we'll do it all over again and make the next change, or don't make the next change. You might make a change and you measure again and you see that there's no impact at all, or that the impact is negative. So you probably want to refer to that change, but it will give you information. So measure, measure, measure. And of course, we're here with Exyn, and we with Dave team as well will help you with that. And the first step is get trained. You can get trained. We have great training for that and great certifications from Exyn as well, so that you know that what you're actually doing is learning and will help you. A lot of what I taught today is from the foundations training. So we go a lot deeper in that training on topics like this, but also we'll build on that and we can help you to make the first steps in that way as well. So with that being said, it's now 4:45, and I think it might be a good idea to have some questions in the last quarter of this hour that we had reserved for this webinar.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much for this great presentation. We do have questions coming. We've got a question here, great presentation. Do you have some examples about how DevOps is well implemented, successful in real life?
Yeah, there's a bit of a... how do I say that? In some way, that's a bit difficult, because you could say, okay, this is the standard implementation of DevOps, but that doesn't exist. There's not something like DevOps out of a box, and please follow these guidelines, and then you will be okay. because it's all about your value stream. And what I see happening a lot is that people say Spotify is a great example. We have to have the Spotify model implemented, and that's kind of an organizational model on how you can change from the specializations from front end, middleware, and stuff like that to having more a customer focus. But that might not help you at all. You have to really do it yourself. I've read a story once that that applies to this, and that back in the 1960s, something like that, somebody from America, from the United States, went to Toyota to see how they created cars, and they copied the car manufacturing system exactly. But they forgot to see that it's not about how all the conveyor belt works and how they put it in, and how their value stream worked, but it's about changing every day over and over again. So you have to get into that culture and mindset of improving every day on your process. And then there's not a standard process. Your situation in your company with your customers is different than mine. And although the principles will apply to all of us, the outcome will be quite different from the situation where you're in. So if you think, okay, this DevOps stuff, you've got me, I want to do something with it, please give me 10 DevOps, that's not something that exists. You have to look at your value stream, improve on your value stream every day over and over again, because that only will give you what we really will call DevOps, and it's not something you can buy out of a box.
Okay, thank you. I've got a question here from Jay. How do you identify which part needs to be automated?
Yeah, that's I said somewhere in the presentation that you should automate almost everything, and maybe it's about the almost part. So it has to make sense, and when it makes sense is when your customer has more value out of it. So again, please measure. And when you look at automation, you quite quickly, I think lead time might be one of the most interesting performance indicators for that, because automation of your process will help you in reducing your lead time. And again, this is a difficult question to answer in general, because I'm not sure how far you are with your automation. And for some people, it might be interesting to start with version control because they never implemented version control at all. For other people, it might be interesting to make a complete automated test environment in the cloud with Terraform or whatever, because they have everything else in place but have a problem with their test environments. So again, and it feels a little bit like repeating, but I really want to stress that. Take a deep look at your own value stream, see how you want to add value to your customer, and try to find a bottleneck in your value stream for enabling more value for your customer. And it might be automating something. It might also be something completely different, because if you automate it, but you don't change your culture in that mindset of over and over improving your value stream, then automation doesn't make that much sense at all.
Okay. Then there is a question about where the training material will be available. I think it's kind of a more broader question coming back. If people want to get trained by you or want to have a look into what the training will look like, where should they go? Or what should they do?
Yeah, well, to be completely honest, at this moment we are refining it still. So we are putting the last things in place. So at this moment you won't be able to find it on our website. But if you're interested, I can share a lot with you already. So please contact me. I will make sure that you get all the information that we have so far, and we will push it to get it on our website as soon as possible.
All right. Then another question about which platform of the Agile flavors does DevOps work best or does combine the best?
And do you have any idea what we mean with platform?
Okay. No. Shall we take another question? Go ahead.
I could say if it's about should I use Scrum or should I use Kanban or any other thing, I would say there's often a comparison made between Agile and DevOps, and they're actually two kind of separate things. Yeah, if you do DevOps, you probably do Agile because hey, that works better than the waterfall way of working. We found that out a while ago. But the way that you, so you could think about safe or less or just doing scrum of scrums or stuff like that. It's kind of a presentation in itself, because I would say try to not scale your agile implementation, but try to make your work as small as possible. So I'm not a big fan of all the scaled agile framework stuff, because that seems like you want to make, again, a lot of control structures in place to control a big thing, while you want to focus on your customer value for your team. But that's actually a kind of complete separate presentation. But in a broad sense, I would say try to make your work as small as possible to be able to make to do it in one team. And if you use Scrum or Kanban, kind of depends on what kind of work you're in and also the flavor that you like most. It's not, I don't feel that one is better than the other.
Okay. Where have you found successes with a DevOps implementation across the organization other than IT-based organizations?
Yeah, that's you see that a lot in I mentioned a couple of these come on, I can't get the word out of my mouth of the companies that disturb the other companies, the Airbnb, the Uber, stuff like that. And what you see there is that the there's not that sharper line between business and IT. We just try to get customer value out of the gates. And yeah, there are people that do IT stuff. There are people that do what we used to call business stuff, but that difference isn't there anymore. And that's actually maybe the best way to add. That's maybe something that you want to aim for. But I'm a bit hesitant to say that as well, because it's not that much about, I don't want any silos anymore, but I want to make sure that I align over silos. At some point, you're just, the size of your company is that large that you need to have some different departments doing different stuff. You can't push everything in one department sometimes. So you might want to change it, but take a good look at Conway's law. How do you organize it so that you can actually create value for your customer? And then try to involve your whole value stream. And I see that now, as I said, I'm in Holland, and I see that happening in a lot of banks at the moment, that they actually, I see it starting a lot in IT departments. And I think that's because a lot of IT people, developers, people in the infrastructure departments see this happening, and they like automation. They see it happening. They start automating, but then it gets picked up. People say, "Hey, but this is actually working, and I do get my value quicker." And then people get interested, and then they will come to you and see, "Hey, what are you doing, and why is this working?" So I like that way a lot, and then it's step by step by step. And yeah, I would love to see every company just forgetting all about the difference between IT and business, because at the end, we're all trying to add value to our customer. I don't see that happening a lot yet, but I see especially but that's also because the last couple of years I've been working with a lot of banks. I see that by doing it right in IT, people in the business get interested, because they used to have that IT company that they had no influence at all. And now people from the IT company department come to the business department and say, "Hey, how can I help? Because I have this new way of working and I think I can help you in a better way." And they all of a sudden get helped instead of getting blocked on everything they want to do. And then they are completely on board, because you don't have to explain to the business that it's about adding value to customers. That's what they have on top of mind. That's something we have to explain more to IT people probably. So if the IT guys understand that, then the step to the business is very easy to make and not that hard to do anymore.
Okay, thank you. Again, a question about the training. If I would like to start the team trained on DevOps, do they have to start with the foundation, or can they proceed to professional or the masters? What would your advice be?
Yeah, well, that depends, of course, a bit on your experience. Eh? Mm-hmm. As I said, a lot of what I taught this today comes from the foundation training. So we talk a lot about of these subjects in the foundation training. So if you say, "Hey, this is something that I know and interesting to hear again, but I actually already knew that," then please go ahead with the other ones. There's some more information that we can provide you with on what's in what training. But it might also be interesting to just set up a call and say, okay, where are you? What's your problem at the moment? And how can we help you best? And what training do you need now?
All right. Another question about what would be the way you can transform into a devil's mindset? Is it top down versus bottom up? And how would you approach such a transformation?
Yeah, that's that's actually one of my small hobbies in life. This is a kind of, I would say, a sandwich approach. I said earlier that you see a lot of developers and people in operation roles that totally are into that automation part. So they like the tools, they probably download it at night, play with it at home, make the nicest stuff on their Raspberry Pi, and it all works, and they have to create stuff running. And they want to use it in their work as well, because it's just cool to do. And that goes a long way. That's a big force that that you have to take into account, because that really brings you a long way. But you have to have a sponsor at the top. And with at the top, I mean CIO level, maybe CEO level, because we are talking about a cultural transformation. It's not just tools, it's the cultural transformation. And I deeply believe that you only change a culture in your company from the top. The problem, and now I might be exaggerating a bit, but no, I don't think so. The problem is in the middle layer. So in larger companies, you have a big layer of what I call middle management. And I've been a middle manager myself, so I feel comfortable talking about it and even maybe say not that nice things about it, because what the purpose of the middle management layer is to have stuff working. And they want to have the Excel sheet green. They want to have all the traffic lights in the Excel sheet on green, and they don't want to have disturbance. And the CIO tells them, hey, this needs to happen, and they will make sure that it happens. That is something that's very important to have in a company, because it makes your company run. But it's very disturbing if you have it during a transformation. You want to have them out of the way when you transform. So what I like to set up a lot is having a top manager and some people from the, let's say just a developer and operation guys, connect these two together and skip the middle management layer, because in the middle management layer, a lot of what you need of the energy to get the transformation done will be, it will get lost in that middle layer. So in the transformation itself, my suggestion always is to get the middle management out of the way, but keep them happy, because in the end, you need them again. If you have that new organization running, you need people that keep that organization running, and that's the job of a middle manager, and that's what they're very important for. But that's also why you don't want to have them in a transformation, because they're not, their mindset is not transformation, their mindset is stability of an organization.
All right, thanks. We still have time, I think, for one more question. We have a lot of questions come in, but we will, as said, we'll answer them then in separate emails. So DevOps is a customer-focused approach similar to IT service management. How these two frameworks are related? Where are the touch points and the overlaps, etc.?
Yeah. Oh man, this is a. Do you have 2 days for me? But it is quite an interesting subject, because it's often seen as something that's opposites to each other. Right? We now do DevOps, let's get rid of the whole ITSM stuff, and ETL stuff is mentioned then a lot as well. We don't need all that process stuff, let's get rid of it. I don't think that's true. I think it's very valuable to have these processes in place, but you have to look at these processes, and that might be something that we forgot to do, from that value stream perspective again. So we have that process in place. Why? What's the value added with that process to our customer? And you will find that these processes do add value, but that you might want to change them a little bit if you look at these processes with these focus. Because what I see happening a lot in more traditional companies that have that ITSM and ITIL stuff completely implemented, that a process and somebody managing the process is kind of becoming one and the same. So I have a change manager that does the change management process. And that's a weird way to do it if you look from it from a DevOps perspective. But that's not to say that we have to get rid of the change management process. That might be an interesting process. You probably want to make it very, very lightweight and not as heavy as it's now in a lot of companies. So you will change that process. But please don't get that process out of the window, because it's like it adds value. but it might not add the value in a way that you want. So you might want to change the process if you look from it from a perspective of customer value. But I think a lot of these processes that we're used to having do add value, but we might have made them too heavy on what they actually bring. So the cost might be too big, and I think we can make them more lightweight than they are now, but I'm hesitant to just throw it away. So I think there's a big overlap, and it's more on how do I look at to my processes, what do I want to get out of my processes, and how do I implement that correctly, instead of, okay, that ITIL didn't work for us, let's get it out of the window. I would totally not recommend to do that.
All right, thank you so much. Again, thanks for a great webinar and a good Q&A round. This is the end of the webinar. I'd like to thank all the attendees, and we will send you the email with the recording and the answers to the questions ASAP. Thank you so much.
Thank you.